Hello. In this video, let's take a look at all the AWS components we're going to use for implementing our microservice architecture, which is the food order system. In the previous video, we have gone over this diagram that we see on the screen right now. We went over the architecture, we went over the design of the application and went over how we're going to implement the design and how which component and how the workflow is going to look like for different use cases that we have listed on the screen, right? As we can see, we have three use cases and we have discussed in that video. I'll put a little link to that video in the description so that if you guys are interested, you can take a look at that as well. So in there, we have discussed how we are going to add more endpoints to the application so that we can start scaling it and provide a better use case for provide a better usability for different use cases, right? So there is and we discussed that, and as we have said multiple times that we're going to use AWS services entirely to implement this application here. So now we are at the point where we have gone over the workflows and gone over the data at the schema that we're going to use to pass over the multiple microservices. And as we can see here, we have described that very well, and the arrows kind of indicate that. So let's take a look at another piece of the whole puzzle. As we're going to call it at the architecture diagram, where we're going to replace these blocks here with AWS services, which we are going to use to implement this application, and how we are going to implement it and what we are going to do and what are the different components that we should take a look at, or we should describe or different features in those services that we should take a look at. We'll try and go over that here as well. So this over here is called the application system component diagram. And as you can see, I've tried to replace most of the services that we have listed, or most of the blocks that we have listed there, with an AWS service. So the most notable of them is on the top, is called the authentication system, and we're going to use Amazon Cognito for doing that. One of the major advantages of Cognito is that it is kind of free to start off with, and you'll have to pay for the service only if you have more than 50,000 active users per month. So it is a very good service to start off with. Some of the other things that we discussed is we're going to use social sign-ins as an added feature eventually for users to not have to create an email account or not have to create another account with us. So that is something that would be very helpful with Cognito. It natively allows us to do that, and that is a great feature as well. Other things that Cognito provides out of the box is a GUI that we can use to sign in, and then we can add certificates to it using ACM, or we can bring in our own certs and try and make it more of like a better user experience and all. So sign-in box is available. Our sign-in is available out of the box, and we don't even necessarily have to pay right from the get-go. We can bring in some like social sign-ins as well. At the same time, one of the things that we discuss is like the application keys that we use, or we want to try and retain or only provide all the relevant authenticated or relevant user information to our apps, and not have data leakages in our whole system eventually, right? So Cognito would be a great place for us to manage that, as we can try and restrict that if we decide to use user pools or create user pools, which is what we're going to do for this application, and try and restrict that per app key. So that is why we're going to go with AWS Cognito here. So now if we look at the entry point, we have three use cases listed here. The entry point over here is going to be API gateway. Very similar to that, the login screen, we can add our own certs to API gateway. That is a great user experience. At the same time, API gateway provides us with the abilities to have multiple endpoints, which we want out of from the beginning, and we want to grow our application eventually. So that would be a great place for us to have multiple endpoints. And each of those endpoints will have a Lambda function or a serverless application that would be servicing that specific endpoint. So there's this natively it will allow us to do that. And from that point on, there'll be other services that we'll have to interact with. IAM is one of the services that we'll have to take a look at so that we can just try and restrict our permissions that we use. That would be a great start as well. So AWS API gateway is a great entry point. And we're going to have multiple Lambda functions, so that each endpoint will have one. And from that point on, the triggers of the Lambda triggers are going to be a very important use case that we're going to use for having the microservice trigger multiple components of the applications here. So one of them as a use case is like the order details from the Lambda function is going to be going into Amazon MQ. And just for the sake of having exposure to different services, I'm going to try and implement one of them in ActiveMQ and the other one in RabbitMQ just for the sake of implementing it. But in a real world application, I would never want to do that. I would just try and stick it to one component, one service, and try and have a better scalability. We'll talk more about that as we start coding and start adding more features and doing infrastructure as code and all that stuff on this application or this service. So Lambda triggers can be a good entry or input and output from our Lambda functions and to and for from our Amazon MQ services. So that is going to be a big component in the whole process where we try and we have our data, relevant data, which is being passed in, and then we'll have code written to our Lambda functions to start processing that information. One of the most important feature in Amazon MQ is we can have batch processing. Lambda is one of the services that as we start invoking more and more of those individually, it starts incurring more and more cost. As our application becomes popular, and we have discussed previously that we're going to add tiering in our application services so that we can have different processing ways so that and different feature offerings. So we don't necessarily have to restrict to a certain use case to our end users. Right? As an example, a certain user or a certain application or certain end user of our application who would not be the user who's putting the food order, but the one who is using the system, right? The restaurant in this case, they would be very popular and they would have 50 orders every minute or every hour. And they are okay with having 50 orders updated in a different, in a triggered fashion, just from a cost perspective. And that is something as an application system, you should be able to provide that. It may not be necessarily a very, very, very user interactive use case, but if need be, there should be provision in the system to do that. So for that, we're going to try and code our Lambda functions to do batch processing from the start. And if the Lambda trigger is for every message, our system should be able to handle it. That is one of the requirements that we can try and implement using Lambda triggers and Amazon MQ. And if it is not able to, or we decide to have 50 messages being triggering a Lambda function or triggering a invocation, we should be able to do that as well. So that is one of the things that we're going to try and have it implemented. So this is going over some of the services here. One more service that we can talk about is DynamoDB. So we'll go over the partitioning of DynamoDB and go over what primary key is and what primary key we are going to use so that we can try and restrict the usage or availability of data to a certain use case or a certain user. Right? We'll try and go over that and try and see how we can do global tables and how we can do backups for our system so that we don't necessarily lose information. And recovery of the system is something that we'll eventually start getting into, as we'll try and look into DR scenarios as well. So the DynamoDB will be of great interest in those kind of discussions. Amazon S3 is the backend data store. I may have discussed that or kind of spoken about it in the previous video. So Amazon S3 is going to be the storage system that we're going to use. We're going to try and see how we can partition our data better over there so that we don't try and pile on to one specific folder and we don't necessarily have bottlenecks. That may not be an issue given the fact that one of our use cases or one of our endpoints is going to expire our previous objects as well. Amazon S3 allows us to implement a use case where the system fails and some of the PDFs that were created never get cleaned up because the triggering for order fulfilled never happened. That doesn't mean that we have to carry on that cost and keep that in, right? So there is a reasonable amount of time after which a food order is not really relevant. So we can try and implement transitioning and deleting objects on S3 service itself. So that way we can try and restrict our cost based on the age of the object. So that is one thing that we will take a look at in that service as well. So to go over, for the most part, we're going to use authentication system and API gateway, which would be interacting with authentication system directly. Previously, we had to use Lambda authorizers that gave us the relevant information, which is the tokens that needed to be passed in or that needed to be inspected to let the Lambda function be invoked. This is natively available in API Gateway, and we try and see if we can use a different authentication system and see how the challenges are, how that integrates, or how that gets implemented as well. That would be a separate video, not necessarily a part of this design series. I hope you like this video, and please like and subscribe this channel so that you can get more videos like these, and hit the notification bell so that you can be notified when we have a new video being rolled out. Thank you so much for watching, and have a wonderful day.